fortunate ones who travel these hallways will, if they happen to refrain from texting long enough, have the opportunity to browse the code of ethics for the Society of Professional Journalists. They will be invited to work as a DJ for the cult radio station and will be told exactly what they can do with a communication degree. Each one will be instructed to buy a dictionary and will be shown a list of rules for teachers in 1872. And it will be clear time and time again that this is a safe space and that they are all quite important. These, all excited and hopeful, will be warned to stop, to not disturb the infinitely significant professional development activities of a faculty member, unless, of course, they came bearing chocolate or wine. They will also be cautioned that a drama queen is just ahead and will be very clearly directed to go to mediate.com if they got conflict. And each one will pause when asked if they like to argue. They will be charged with thinking deeply about issues, and they will ponder, resolved, the United States should legalize all or nearly all of one or more of the following in the United States. Marijuana, for some reason spelled with an H. Online gambling, physician-assisted suicide, prostitution, the sale of organs. The insightful command to prepare, advance, excel will ring in their ears. And yet, located in the shadows of Lang Hall, outside the doors of Lang 360, there is a whimpering. Sniveling sniffles that suggest that here, in the Department of Lake Woe's Begone, there exists, dare I say, evidence of weeping. Paper is shuffled and books thud into boxes as Dr. Phyllis Scott Carlin, destroyer of woes, demolisher of disasters, calmer of calamities, quietly packs her office and prepares for new adventures. Students and colleagues sniffle and snort with thanks, for it is here where she transformed what could have been Lake Woeful to Lake Woe's Begone. Here she guided our best and brightest, and this our home department of Lake Woe's Begone. She challenged and inspired to open their minds, to open their hearts, and to open their worlds. These, our best and brightest, thanks to Dr. Phyllis Scott Carlin, will not walk away from here. Our Lake Woe's Begone, Lake Woe's Begone, unchanged. Each and every one within themselves will somehow hopefully know and deeply understand after their travels here, I changed myself, I changed the world. That's the news from Lake Woe's Begone, where all the staff are strong, all the faculty are good looking, and all the students strive to be average.
Five things I wish Phyllis would have told me before accepting a position in performance studies at UNI. One, you will teach classes other than performance studies. Communication theories, research methods, nonverbal communication, beginning tap. You will direct shows, direct research projects, research papers, theses, committees, and traffic, if needed. There are four major food groups: caffeine, 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 and wine. Four, the couch in the green room is for Paul and Karen, not for new assistant professors. Five, Paul and Karen can't sleep on the couch in the green room all of the time.
Thank you, Danielle. As we all know, tonight is about celebrating the career of Phyllis Carlin. So Phyllis, if you would, please join me up here at this time, and we'll talk a little bit about your time at UNI. Phyllis, we'll kind of start at the beginning. You grew up on a farm in Missouri. You should tell us a little bit about growing up on the farm in Missouri.
Definite heritage in agriculture. Great, great grandparents on all sides, all tracks, were pioneers and homesteaders. From that time period to when my father bought our farm just after returning from World War II. So I grew up in 4-H doing what the usual farm kids do, but I would have to say I was not a total hard worker. so my parents allowed me to read books, walk through the woods, collect rocks, study the wildflowers, write plays, write poetry, and read a lot of books. Didn't leave a lot of time for some of those other chores that you sometimes think in the ideal that that's what farm kids do, but that was not the case.
So how did you decide, you first became a high school teacher.
That's right.
So
yes.
How did you decide to become a high school teacher?
I wanted to be a teacher from about third grade on. And in high school, I figured out that what I really wanted to do is teach college. And my favorite subjects were always in the area of literature and language. And so it just seemed very natural. And then we had a neighbor who moved in somewhere around high school. And he happened to be an English professor at the university and wrote poetry. So that was, I think, another helpful person to meet at that point. So it was never really a huge decision where I sat and thought about it. It just seemed the thing to do.
And after you taught high school for a few years, you went to Southern Illinois University.
I only taught high school for 2 years,
2 years
because I already knew that that's what I wanted to do.
So why'd you go to SIU?
I went to SIU because I had three professors who had gone to SIU, and I liked what they were doing with their classes. I liked what they said about SIU. And then someone told me about Marion Kleino and how wonderful it would be to work with her, and that was true, and so she became my dissertation advisor. And I wanted to study not just performance studies, I wanted to study everything. And so they had interpersonal, they had rhetoric, they had the full range. It just was appealing to me, and it was a good place to go.
So you came to UNI in 1976 and never left.
Yes.
Why?
You know, that wasn't the plan. I thought I would come for a few years and put up with the cold weather, possibly for just a little while. But then I found that there were so many opportunities to create things. The department was in a position where it was growing and changing, and so I got to invent all these new classes, and no one ever said no. I want to offer this class, I want to invent this class, I want to do this project. And at that point, it was in this state of growth, and so I was very much encouraged, and so I was just challenged by it and intrigued by it. And then I was able to change myself and transform myself and continue to invent new things. So, and I liked the students so much. And another big factor was marrying a native Iowan who had a job here. That was rather important. And I think we thought it was a good place to stay because we loved our work, a good place to raise a family. And so I didn't leave, and here it is, 38 years later.
And then when you got here, you became involved in the performance studies program. It wasn't called that at the time,
that's
in the Interpreters
right.
Theater. Could you talk a little bit about some of the things that you did with the Interpreters Theater and some of the changes you might have seen?
That's of course a longer story than maybe what people want to hear. But when I came, I was told that I was going to be the coordinator of words and voices. And people have asked me, was that a choral reading group or something? But it wasn't. It was simply the preliminary phase of what was evolving into Interpreters Theater group performance in this country. But I had just come from SIU. I knew what the caliper stage looked like. It was a black box, a lot like this one. And so when they said, you're going to do this program, I just decided, okay, we'll use the SIU model. But the good thing about this position was there was a track in the teaching emphasis where you could major in interpretation, almost unheard of in most campuses. And so that's what I inherited, was something that was already there to build from. So that's what it looked like when I came. There were a group of students who were really interested in doing this. And once again, I said, I want to change this to interp theater. I want to do it this way. And they said, okay. That was the beginning.
And one of our first surprises for you tonight is a performance by one of your former students. And this is Dr. Dennis Doyle from Central College, and he will be performing the poem The University by James Hirst.
D. The architecture of scholarship survives. Time may break stained glass windows and tumble stones, but the edifice of faith and thought, poetry, art, harmony, the probing sciences, stands wherever men have cherished it. Time, the vandal, cannot tear it down. Only men at war with themselves and the heat of prejudice can shake its walls. Scholarship walks the corridors looking for open doors. The petty politicians of the classrooms squawk like parrots, repeating the thought of wiser men. They read coffee grounds as portents and prove to students that a sow's ears can be made from a silk purse. But the challenge of the mountain streams out in its flag of snow, and hardy climbers roped together spend their lives in the ascent. These are the true masters who have worked their way from the image in the rock to the star that shaped it. All is not vanity. The skilled workman from the past quarries the stones to build today's chapel where students begin their novitiate in the disciplines of the humanities and sciences. Experience is our dictionary. We learn its language and meaning from our notebooks. Words are spoken by the farmer, carpenter, priest, and scholar. We train our hands with thought, our minds with the muscles of research and with experiment. Living is our aim, to learn to stand on our own feet, speak our minds, find health in the healing strength of our own character. Now, in the shelter of the university's everlasting arms, is the time to dream of revolution, to hoist new banners over old glories, to know the worth of bread and cheese and wine. We are free to fly the balloons of dreams, to trim the fat from rich promises. The coming days, shrouded in their anonymity, may wear the scornful masks of the master of slaves or the open faces of free men. The will to choose lies with the mind and eye of the beholder. Then shall we learn that nature is ever reflected in the spirit of ourselves, where life, blood warm, may nourish itself on peace and wisdom.
That poem that was performed by Dennis might remind you of one of your early shows, Furrows and Gates. Do you remember that show? Can you tell us a little bit about Furrows
yes,
and Gates?
Yes, I do, but before I tell you about that, I'm going to tell you that Dennis was in the first show that I directed, Scandinavian Folk Tales. We performed in a lecture hall in Sabin because we had no place to actually call it, and so it was a lecture hall over there. And I think you referred to this earlier, but I think it's really something to have someone from my very first cast here, and then reading James Hurst, which is a transition into what was maybe the next show. I'm not sure what was the next show. But there were actually two productions of James Hurst's work, and they accidentally happened in the same academic year. This was not really something that I planned, but it happened. I accepted a grant from the Iowa Humanities Board to tour a show based on his poetry, but before we could get to the tour, there was a community tribute for James Hurst, and I was asked to do that for Reader's Theater also. And so, two semesters in a row, I was working with two separate scripts based on his poetry.
And did you interview Hurst, or how did
yes,
you
we had,
make
we had several we had several conversations with him, and he was very friendly to us. I think it was rather intimidating to me as a beginner here to be working with a poet's work and knowing that he was going to be there. And furthermore, he was living in Cedar Falls, and if he didn't like it, I would be seeing him. and so I felt very responsible. And so I felt very responsible to get it right. But he was very generous. He was very kind to us, and he did love what the students were doing with his work.
Now, Hurst was also a farmer. Did that have any impact on your work? Some poems from farm?
Well, that's really how I first became interested in his work, because people kept telling me, because of my interest in farms, that I really needed to be looking at James Hurst's poetry, and I needed oh yeah, okay, okay. And then one day it just happened and I realized this is the literature I want to work with, because he was a farmer poet and a poet who farmed. You don't necessarily always have that. You have poets who write about farms but maybe aren't farmers also. But he knows what he's talking about, and in many ways I think that he was predicting what unfolded in the 80s. He did pass away before we had an official farm crisis title, but he certainly had articulated a lot of those difficulties.
Did you have any poems of his that were your favorites?
Yes, I do. There's one that is really funny, where it's about a farm couple, a young farm couple, who are in an argument about how to plant the garden. And he is telling her, you have to plant it in straight rows. And she is saying, why? That these plants should be allowed to grow freely. What's the point in having straight rows? And that was really funny. And I think that one's called The Way It Is or something like that. There's another one. He didn't write a lot of things from the point of view of women, but there's one that's about 3 pages long. And it's a monologue, narrative kind of poem from the perspective of an aging farm woman who goes to sit in the junkyard where all the rusty old machinery is sitting and talking about her life. And it's really a beautiful piece and very sensitive, I think, to the point of view of women. And then I also like the one that's called Retirement Time is the Time to Retire. There's a line in there that goes something like, you are not the first old farmer to close the door or something. And just the tone of it. It just says, shape up. Other people have done this and it's time.
So can I ask how long that has been one of your favorite poems? Is that a recent favorite?
And then I also would like to tell you that there is a cast member here. There are two cast members here from some of those James Hirst shows. So Cindy Cohn is over there. And she was in the one that had the Iowa Humanities Grant. We toured it 5 different places. It was hard work, wasn't it, Cindy?
Oh, it was great work. Yeah. And then I married a farmer. So.
Yeah. And then Jay Edelman. At the James Hirst tribute, he played a young farmer. I'll bet you never played a young farmer ever before.
Well, we've actually chosen one of your favorite poems to perform just now. Bill Carpenter and April Chatham Carpenter will now perform The Way It Is.
Oh, wow. How did you know?
Prepare the ground, I told her. Channel a straight row. Select the seeds, drop them in the open furrow, and cover them. Observe these facts, I said, to keep a garden from being helter-skelter. A radish seed won't become a turnip because it's in a turnip row. Seeds carry instructions, even the season. Know it. Look how corn sweats and heats at planting time.
Lectures in her ears, a mosquito buzz in bed. Why tug nature's skirts, she asked. Let things grow their own way. All this digging and raking and pulling a string tight just to make a straight row. Does a radish care? Why not crooked rows? Room for more seeds. Look at you pulling weeds. Don't weeds have rights? Aren't they alive with a will to grow?
I chopped angrily, hoed out a young cabbage plant, and left a thistle standing.
James Hirst would love the way you did that.
Now, you began your research into the farm crisis in January of 1985 while you were on a professional development leave from UNI. Mm-hmm. Can you tell us a little bit about how you went about that research?
What happened there, well, I had a leave to actually do another project. And so I was at home attempting to write on this project, and I kept seeing the coverage of the farm crisis on the news and these very small clips of little momentary bits of conversation with farmers. And given my own background, I knew I had to investigate that. And so I started traveling around and interviewing farmers and spending time with them on their farms, and also interviewing people who were working with them, like the bankers, the extension agents, and others in the community. Primarily, though, I interviewed farmers who were about to lose their farm, or who had lost it, or were experiencing great stress. And so that really became the major project of that lead, and I put the other one aside until later.
Now, for 30 years, you've been known as one of the national experts on providing a human voice to the farm experience. How did you go about creating, getting the human voice part?
Well, I recorded the oral histories, and then I traveled in various community places and conferences, various kinds of locations, finding ways to share those voices. And so sometimes I actually played the actual tape stories, the most moving parts, and the parts that would allow someone else to understand what was going on with them. And if we couldn't do that, or if it didn't seem like that would work, then I had student performers who actually took the oral history narratives and performed them. And so in that way, the voices of the farmers were being heard in places where they really hadn't been before. And then somehow a New York radio station heard about this. I think they had come to Iowa to do some coverage. And so the New York radio station, it was an NBC radio station, asked if they could play excerpts from these interviews so that people in New York could understand what in the world was going on out in the farming community. And so there was a 5-part series that came on the New York radio station. And you know, generally I think it's hard to even tune in this particular station from here, but for some reason the week that played, I could turn it on every morning and hear it.
Now, your work on that project was also featured in the Smithsonian Folklife Festival?
No, that was a different project.
Different project.
Yes,
what would
10
you tell
years,
us about?
Yes, 10 years later, no one's talking about the farm crisis anymore. I can't say that I think everything was completely solved and wrapped up, but that term was not so much being used, and it seemed that some things might be resolving themselves. But one thing that I had noticed when I was out there, I didn't hear the voices of farm women. I mean, why are they called farm wives? Why are they called farm women? What's their story? And since I had quite a few farm women as my own ancestors, I really wanted to go back and focus on the women's stories. And so that is the project that the Iowa Folklife director and I were talking about that, and that's how we got to the Folklife Festival, because we were focusing on the state of Iowa in 1996. And she wanted to include this work. And there actually is a person in this audience who helped me with that project, Carmen Maiman. She was one of the key farm women in this research project, and she was my partner in this research. She went to a convention, and then she and her family and their cattle traveled to Washington, D.C. with me to present the story of what farm life is like. And Carmen is a wonderful advocate and educator and storyteller, and she was able to give voice to farm women as no one else could. And we've been friends now ever since, so that's going on, I think, 24 years now.
I was going to ask you what that, having your work displayed at the Smithsonian, meant to you. Before I ask, though, my first experience with you was actually indirectly through that. That when I was getting ready to interview at UNI, I sat down and went through the website, and the first names on the list were Melissa Beal, who I had known for years, and so I clicked on her name real quick, and I was like, yeah, she's as good as I thought. And the next one was Mary Bozick, who I didn't know, but I'd heard a lot about from my advisor. I was like, yeah, Mary's everything he says. And then, so the first person I don't know at UNI is Dr. Carlin. And I click on the link, and I was instantly impressed by the University of Northern Iowa. I remember going through your curriculum vitae, your CV, and really focusing on that your work had been displayed at the Smithsonian. I was an instant admirer from a distance, just as I was kind of doing it. So what did it have to, so what did you think? Were you as impressed as I was?
Actually, I was pretty impressed that you knew that. That you had done that kind of work prior to the interview, for one thing, and then you understood. And you understood why that's important. And you didn't ask me, well, why did you do that farm topic? That you got it. What's your question?
How did it make you feel to have your work displayed at the Smithsonian?
Well, you know, I was very pleased that it got to that point, because my goal from the beginning was to try to get the voices of these unheard stories out there. Because I didn't think that the actual farmers on the farm were having enough of an opportunity to say what this is like, and what is really going on, and why. And so the fact that it got to Washington, D.C., that other researchers can find this, and they're going to hear the voices of the women that I interviewed, of course, that is satisfying and makes me happy.
We're going to take a break and listen to one of your best known pieces from 1994 called That Black Fall. And it will be performed by Mary Bozick, Jennifer Boyenga, and Kirk and Marilyn Shaw.
Lane off a narrow, curving blacktop, the house is surrounded by the barn and sheds. A two-story white house where 10 children and their parents lived while working on 700 acres still presents a thriving and secure image. It is the family that has changed. The farmer who maintained the buildings and planted the crops committed suicide when he realized they were losing.
Seems like we were one of the first to go. So we could not handle the situation. There weren't the farm crisis coalition groups that are around now getting the publicity out to really help the people. He just talked to friends. He didn't have anybody to really talk to about the financial situation that he was in. It would have made a huge difference if there had been somebody. He had managed to turn everything around, well, up until the fall of 81. Then he could see, starting into the new year, that, he could see that the money was not going to be there to get the ground planted. You know, the financing that it takes to get things, to get crops in the ground. Well, one way or another, he had always managed to make ends meet. He had managed to pay bills and get things done until that black fall. And from that point on, well, it was a nightmare. It was a nightmare for months. He walked the floors at night, he could not sleep, and of course, nobody else could either. I was working. I was trying to take care of my mother. She was dying of cancer at that time. And then our 16-year-old son was smitten with a viral inflammation. That same December, it left him without function in his lower extremities. Randall would say to me, "How can you sleep when you have so many problems and I can't sleep?" And I'd say, "Well, somebody's got to." I think that's all there is to it. I don't know why.
In narrating her husband's descent into total discouragement and extreme stress, she uses an opening statement to introduce the sequence, which is also an accounting for her husband's decision to end his life. "We were one of the first to go." The imagery of that black fall and the imagery of walking the floor at night show attention given to painting the details of personal and emotional experience. The simultaneous events of her husband's stress, along with her mother's cancer and son's illness, show how tragic events built on the farm crisis the family suffered. The scene, as performed, brings to life what had been a conversation from their most stressful days, which she refers to metaphorically as a nightmare for months. These narratives seem to be an accounting for her husband's suicide, demonstrating how he was driven to it by a high level of unbearable stress. The majority of farm families in crisis do not experience the drastic alterations to their lives that a husband's death brings. But no one seems to escape stress from threats of losing a lifestyle, a home place, the work of many years, and in many cases, a legacy of family history and values. While most of the stories focus on making sense of these stressful events, other stories function to further group identity and mutual encouragement among farmers, or to serve as warnings addressed to non-farmers. One farmer's narrative is an example of a fantasized description of violence and protest he predicts can happen.
Now, that can get to be a really ugly situation, and if it ever starts, it's going to be like a wildfire, and it will spread, and it's going to be real bad. It could be a real bad confrontation, so God help us if something like this happens. It would just be like Russia or any place else. If they start fighting over here, you see, if the confrontation with the law and the police, I hear a lot of talk. Nobody's done it, but I've heard an awful lot of talk. I've heard guys say that they'll carry me off of here. Yes, I've heard them say that they'll carry me off of here. And I know what they mean when they say, I had one fellow who told us in Nebraska that they'll carry, that the people out here, he said, we have 1,000 rounds of ammunition for every typewriter that they have.
The same narrator uses stories to paint other future scenarios, such as farmers going into cities and taking over jobs. The therapeutic functions of the stories become apparent. They are grasping for a foothold against a sense of personal failure and loss, projecting a time that their roles as victims will shift to those winners. The importance of a story's original personal and social context, and the meaning for the performer as it first occurs, joins with the importance of shifting audiences and the performer's own awareness of the way stories can be told in different contexts. One July morning, an Iowa woman, Carmen, called to tell me about a severe hail and windstorm that had destroyed more than 900 acres of corn and soybeans on the farm. She asked me to bring the video camera to her farm and document what had happened. Carmen's narrative begins when we get out of my car and walk into the field of broken stalks and stripped leaves.
You've got the money, and you've got the work, and you've got the time, and the hours invested. We took down buildings, and we took down the trees. We picked up all the rocks and the stalks. This will affect us forever. It's a dead horse. You don't have anything for it. It's gone. I'm really negative right now and saying to my husband, this is forever. I don't know if I can handle it. I don't know if I can handle the debt, the extra debt, because I know what, I carry a lot of debt, and I know what that is. I know what that feels like, and I know you can't pay for a dead horse. You just can't.
After narrating her initial efforts to assess losses, she reenacts a conversation with her banker, the reactions of her three children, the plan she and her husband had been discussing, and the neighbor's contributions of food and support. The narrative continues as we get back into the car, and for the first time in the narrative, she jokes about the impossibility of corn ears forming on those ruined stalks. Later, Carmen expressed to me on numerous occasions how her feelings and responses have changed about the impact of the storm upon her life, the way she now interprets the functions of her original tellings. In fact, the The story seems to be continually unfolding, still evolving after more than a year of telling it. Perhaps one of the most compelling realizations I have developed about personal narratives is the necessity of understanding the multiple meaningful contexts, including the performance, the occasion, the perceived audiences, the relationship between teller and researchers, the parallel stories presented in the community, and the circumstances of the video or audio recordings. The interrelated concerns for privacy and risk versus the need to share and the pleasure of finding others with similar stories.
Stories that people tell if they have witnessed or been a survivor of a disaster. It's just that simple. And I focused mainly on disasters like floods, tornadoes, and some man-made disasters.
And why the interest? What have you found?
Why the interest? You know, I was trying to think, how did I get started on that? I really think that it was a couple of things. One was the Titanic movie. And it got me reading everything about the Titanic that I could find. And so I really became interested in that, and so did my students. A lot of students became interested in that. But also I remember being in this space on 9/11. And students coming into class in shock and confusion. And then all the things that we saw during that time period. It didn't take long for many oral histories to come out, and the stories of those who were in the towers, those who witnessed the falling of the towers, it struck me as this is my next narrative project, because these disaster narratives are taking us into what it is to survive the worst, and to deal with those things through story and through the community that is going to support that storyteller. So I became intrigued at that point because of these things, I think, and then I started to read 100 years of disaster narratives from archives and oral history books and other sources. So that's how it happened. I'm sure that one of your next questions might be what my students asked me once. Why? Why are we doing so many, why are we studying death, disaster, all this sad stuff?
All right, I'll ask that.
Okay.
Why are we studying death, disaster, all this sad stuff?
But, you know, usually there was another student who would explain to them, and I wouldn't have to. And I think that there are probably students sitting right here who could answer this as well as I. Because I think that when you have a story that's told at the greatest moment of loss, the greatest moment of tragedy, that is where you really understand us, and you understand how we can connect with each other and help each other, and you find out what's the importance of a story to our community. That's why.
I'm glad I asked.
I'm glad I had you.
So you've been really busy. I mean, I noticed that you talked about multiple projects. Some of the questions we asked were even, that was a different project. So you've been busy for a long time. 38 years at UNI. Retiring must sound pretty good right now. Do you have anything planned other than recovering from 38 years at UNI?
Well, I have quite a few things planned. I'm going to spend a lot more time walking in the woods and playing with my grandchildren, listening to music. But I also have this project. And I requested from Chris Martin the opportunity to just stay in my office for a while because I'm trying to lift this project off the ground. And you will hear some more about that project later, but just briefly, I'm building a network of people. A lot of them, hopefully, people that are right here, focused on stories of place, using online conversation and various ways of gathering us together to look at issues of environment, nature and education, heritage of place, quality of community of life. And so I think there'll be a lot of spin-off projects, but this is not something I'll be doing by myself, and I will be doing all of it. But I see an opportunity to connect some people with some amazing gifts from the people that I have met in these 38 years. And so we're going to be looking for ways to get us together on these topics, all centered on the idea of what does a place mean to us, and how do we make that place better for as many people as we can.
That's a fascinating project. I was telling somebody the other day that I think place is one of the least talked about understood concepts in rhetoric and communication. It's really an interesting topic.
Okay, you'll be on the network.
Oh, with that, I'll take you back to your seat. So, Phyllis, thank you for spending some time with us to help celebrate. And now we'll welcome Dr. Jen Freitag from Dayton, Ohio, who completed both her bachelor's and master's degrees here at the University of Northern Iowa. Jen, thank you for coming all the way from Dayton to be with us tonight.
Maybe I know that we've got trouble in the fields, when the bankers don't like locusts out there to weigh on me. The trains will buy our silos, silver in the rain. They leave our pockets full of nothing and our dreams in the cold rain. Have you seen the folks in the line there downtown at the station? They're buying all their tickets and they're talking the Great Depression. Our parents had their hard times 50 years ago, when they stood out in those empty fields and dust as deep as snow. And all this trouble in our fields, if this rain can fall, these fields can heal. They'll never take our native soil. But if we sell them to John Deere, then we'll work these crops with sweat and tears. You'll be the
there, farmer. You look a little sweaty. Have you been a little overworked? You bet your powdered biscuits.
Oh.
I can't find anybody to help me out.
What a goinkydink. I was just passing through this here communication theater, and I think your solution might be right under your nose.
I'm not trying to take advantage of anybody.
Oh, don't stress. Graduate students love to work.
Wait a second.
All right.
Graduate students?
Yup.
On a farm?
Uh-huh.
What is this, Missouri?
Close. See, we here at Scott's Farmhand Supply love to use graduate students because they'll work for the experience. For little money, for the love of learning, and they don't care if they wear purple.
Wow, can I get a demonstration?
You sure can, farmer. But you'll have to wait just a gosh darn second, and we'll be back in a bit.
Ladies and gentlemen, we're back for our messages from our great sponsor, Scott Farmhand Supply, for our newest episode of What Would Phyllis Carlin Do? Now, tonight's episode is going to feature three contestants from our audience answering hypothetical, ethical situations to try and match up best with what Phyllis Carlin would do. So to get started, let's meet our contestants. First, Melissa Beal. Come on. Things for you. You get a whiteboard and surgical gloves because one of our catchphrases is the situations and these ethical questions will get a little messy. So you're going to need those. Our second contestant is Greta Berghammer. Come on down! And our third and final contestant tonight only is a special wild card. So we are opening it up to anyone in the audience. I need one volunteer to participate in What Would Phyllis Carlin Do? If no one raises their hand, I will just pick. Is there anyone that would like to participate fully in this game? No. Phyllis, do you have anyone in mind? Laura Turlip, come on down. I have some wonderful gloves, a marker. The marker also has an eraser at the top because we will be using it quite a few times. Phyllis, you are also part of this game, so you get this and these. The rules of the game are simple. I will read you a hypothetical, ethical situation with four possible answers. You will choose the best answer that you think the great Phyllis Carlin would choose. Phyllis will also answer the question. If you match up, you'll get an arbitrary amount of points that I will pick, and there will be a winner at the end. So really, it's the newlywed game, but instead of raunchy relational secrets, it's ethical situations, so everyone wins. With that, we are going to begin with situation number one. I'm a first-year faculty member. Come to you, tell you in confidence that a senior faculty member is pressuring me to head a major departmental committee on strategic planning. And she feels she is not able and have enough experience to head this meeting successfully, but she's afraid to say no because this person is her direct supervisor. What would Phyllis Carlin do? A, hopefully four answers will show up if you need to be reminded. Offer to co-chair the committee with her. B, tell her to accept the committee position because there are good members to support her. C, talk to the supervisor and tell him how unfair he is being. Or D, change the subject. So again, first year faculty member, you have a senior faculty member. Audience, feel free to chime in what you think as they all choose. Take a second, write them down. I would hum the Jeopardy theme, but it has been patented. I cannot, so I will just wait.
Just put anything down.
You choose this one. If they match yours,
they can put their answers down first.
Yeah, they can write theirs first, and then you will choose.
See what you write.
And then it'll be a one-by-one flip, and then we will. You contemplate, because this is all about what you would do.
Contemplating.
First year faculty member approaches a senior faculty member, tells you in confidence, I don't think I can do it, but they're my direct supervisor. What would you do? Offer to co-chair. Tell her to do it anyway. C, talk to the supervisor. D, change the subject. Contestants, do you have your answers? Melissa, what did you choose?
B.
B. Tell her to accept the committee chair. She will have good member support. Dr. Turlip.
A.
A. Ooh, we have some dissent already. Offer to co-chair the committee with her. Greta.
I said B.
B. Tell her to accept the committee chair. She will have good member support. We have two Bs, one A. Phyllis, what did you choose? None of the above. Oh, this game is going to go well. What is secret answer E that you have chosen?
Well, I would say that the closest one there might be B, but it needs a little work.
Can you expand on the work?
I think an option here is that this person might consider sending her back to speak with the supervisor and see what could be worked out and explain the concerns. Think about it a little bit more, and possibly there will be a compromise situation.
That sounds like a much better. I'm sorry, you got contestants, you were tricked. Apparently, the game works out results. So it's B-ish. So you get
B-ish.
For the B's, one point. You get half because she chose her own answer. So you're close. All right, situation number two. An undergraduate student you've had in two classes is extremely excited about applying for an MA program that you think that's a bad match. Do you? A. Write the recommendation letter and hope he's happy. B, write the letter emphasizing the mismatch between the student and the program. C, tell him you can't recommend him for that program because the match is toxic. Or D, send him to the career center. Again, undergraduate student, super excited about an MA program that Phyllis doesn't think fits very well. Would you A, write a recommendation letter for him, hope he's happy. B, write a letter that emphasizes the mismatch between him and the program. C, tell him nope, too toxic. D, send him to the career center. Oh, that's not great.
Can we call out answers again?
Yes, call. Feel free. Audience participation is more than welcome on tonight's episode.
Secret answer E.
Secret answer E is always an option. All the contestants have an answer. Yes, yes, yes. We will start on this side again.
I say none of the above, but she would have part of A. She would counsel the student and say that she, if the student really, really feels that they need to go to that school and has adequate reasons why, compelling reasons, she would write the letter of recommendation, but she'd try to counsel that student not to do that. In a very, very gentle, kind way. So none of the above, but with an emphasis on A, before she got there, or after.
I would like to point out that the contestants have just taken over this game. Yes. But I'm okay with that. Dr. Charlotte?
Same thing, but I picked C because I think she would sit down and have a talk with the person first and explain what the program was really like.
All right, so C-ish, which fits because Greta
said C-ish as well.
I just have to say that our answers are a little bit off, apparently. So we have none of the above, A-ish, C-ish, C-ish.
A B C combo.
Would you feel free to elaborate on your alphabet soup answer that you chose?
There's something in each one of those that has potential.
Not the career center?
Of course I would say, If you really want me to write this recommendation, I will, but we need to look at how this is a possible mismatch and talk through that. And I would probably tell him I hesitate to recommend him, but if he really still, after our conversation, feels that's what he wants to apply for, then I will write it.
All right, you all get points. You're all tied, you're winning. This is good. One more. We have one final ethical situation before I arbitrarily, or they may just decide who wins, because that's how it's going. Situation three. The faculty is attempting to reconfigure comprehensive exams. After a nasty meeting, the faculty is split. Half want to make the comps harder. Half want to get rid of them completely. There's 2 days until the next meeting. What would Phyllis Carlin do? A, try to broker a compromise before the meeting, gaining support from key faculty members. B, work on a compromise and introduce it at the meeting. C, let the debate take place. Or my favorite answer, D, go shopping with Karen in the afternoon of the meeting. Again, the faculty is split on comps, half harder, half get rid of those. What would Phyllis do? Broker a deal before. Work on a compromise, introduce it at the meeting. Let it happen by itself. Go shopping with Karen.
Ready? Are you ready? Oh, this is a long... Do you draw a picture?
All A, B, and C.
A, B, and C.
She would broker a compromise from key faculty members. Then she'd work on that compromise and introduce it at the meeting, and then open it up. And then at the end, she would pull it all together again and say, here's my compromise, or here's a way we can address all of the issues.
And then she'll go shopping with Karen.
After shopping after. Yes, exactly.
But these are for the meeting.
For the meeting, A, B, C. D is post-meeting greatness. Dr. Charlie?
A
and B. Broker compromise, work on it at the meeting. Not even going to let the debate take place. Phyllis is going to put her foot down and say, this is happening.
It wouldn't be a debate. Because there would be a compromise.
And finally, Greta.
I just said, why?
When it comes to comps, that is apparently the best answer. Yes. Phyllis.
C and then B.
C and then B. So you would let the debate take place, and then you would step in as the savior superhero mediator.
No. You let the discussion take place.
Of course.
But you don't try to do it ahead of the meeting. I don't think that's good. But I think it's also a good idea if there is a little pre-thinking about what are the possibilities we might propose that would bring this together and resolve it. But I don't think that you come up with that and then convince people to adopt it. I think first you let the discussion occur so that everyone has a chance for input and for conversation. And then together, we all work on this compromise at the meeting.
Yes, that's for Phyllis. Yes. All right, well, since the contestants took over, I'm just gonna pick who I think did the best. So in third place, receiving a hearty round of applause coming in, Dr. Turlip, you get two. This is very important. The grand prize and the prize for all of these are two all expenses paid tickets to the next free Interpreters Theater show. Dr. Paul, another day in paradise. You will love it. It is great. In second place, receiving three tickets. A hearty round of applause. Dr. Bill. And a mean joy winner because she came up with the most creative answer to the comprehensive exams question. Receiving three as well, but you know, we only had eight, so you had three as well. Ladies and gentlemen, please join us next week. week on another episode of What Phyllis Carlin Would Do, where the contestants make up the rules as they go. Thank you, everyone. You can keep the gloves. You keep the gloves.
The only thing that can be more exciting than Paul's next show, Another Day in Paradise, is our very next special guest. They said it couldn't be done, but when it comes to Phyllis Carlin, nothing is too much to ask.
Live. Sort of. For the very first time in the UNI Interpreters Theater, our next very special guest.
group that knows how to keep its secrets. But on the third floor of Lang Hall, one man is still trying to find the answers to life's persistent questions. Guy Noir, Private Eye.
A friend of a friend told me there's trouble afoot in the Communication Studies Department.
How can we convince him to move?
Let's force him. We can't have him commandeering Donna's desk anymore. She's an office coordinator, for crying out loud. How can she coordinate him when he's in the way?
I know you're talking about me. I'm not moving.
Yes, you are. Donna needs her desk back. And there's a perfectly good desk for you in Phyllis's office.
Bettina's right. We can't let you stay in the main office.
Come on. I can't move in there.
Why?
It's cursed. People say if you touch the door handle, you'll burn your hand. If I burn my hand, I can't type. If I can't type, I can't publish more articles. I'll never get tenure.
A cursed office. That sounds like a case for Guy Noir, Private Eye. That's me. None of the other doors are black. Has this one always been?
Well, it wasn't black yesterday.
I'm Guy Noir, Private Eye. Okay. I'm investigating this allegedly cursed office.
Okay, yeah, it wasn't black yesterday.
So it turned black overnight.
Well, it looks that way. I mean, it looks kind of rotten. I should probably get this replaced where it spreads to my office.
Where's your office?
Well, right next door.
That's interesting.
I know we got a spare door. We got a spare door around here somewhere.
Entities must not be multiplied beyond necessity.
What?
Occam's razor. It's a caution against needlessly complicated explanations. Perhaps there's a simple explanation here.
Are you accusing me of something?
Not yet.
He replaced the door and it turned black.
A curse he placed when he turned his back.
This happened to a friend of a friend. She touched the door and met her end.
From graduate school, she had to flee. As she no longer typed perfectly.
It's cursed.
Or worse.
He replaced the door and it turned black.
A curse she placed when he turned his back.
This happened to a friend of a friend. He walked by the door and tripped on a pen.
He dropped his laptop. It shattered to bits. Along with his nearly completed thesis.
It's cursed.
A manifestation of her displeasure.
He replaced the door and it turned black.
A curse she placed when he turned his back.
I heard it from a friend of a friend. She's angry because she can't believe that a TA could teach ethnography.
This happened to an adjunct I know. She left an offering outside the door and then she won a teaching award.
It's cursed.
Or enchanted.
He replaced the door and it turned out.
Enough with the door. Enough.
But it's haunted.
Friend of a friend, burned hands, broken theses, teaching awards, curses, enchantment, haunting, a spontaneously darkening door. Could it be that we're witnessing the birth of an urban legend? We need to call in some experts. What are you testing?
It's a PKE meter. It can tell us if there's supernatural energy present. Stop bugging me, I need to concentrate.
And what are you testing?
Did you know doors can get sick like people?
I did not know that.
Well, I'm looking for tree sickness.
And if the door is sick, what's the prognosis?
It's bad. It's really, really bad.
And what's your shtick?
Oh, it's not a shtick. Just good old-fashioned chromatography, spectrography, maybe some microbiology. I'm taking a few samples from the door and I'll analyze them back in the lab to find out what's going on.
You got a hypothesis, Doc?
Well, I'm pretty sure they're both wrong. In fact, just as I suspected, it's not supernatural. And it's not a mysterious door sickness.
You can't know that.
You can't rule things out just yet. Yes, I can. Because it's paint. I'll send you an invoice.
It's paint. Now we've got to find out who's the artist. Could it be the graduate assistants? Rumor has it that disgruntled graduate assistants are agitating for another office. With 10 bodies crammed into one office this year, they could certainly use some extra space, they say. Could it be Karen Mitchell? Normally seen in wildly colorful outfits, she's taken wearing all black this year. Supposedly because she's mourning Phyllis Carlin's retirement. Has she taken her mourning too far? Hey, wait, that's not even funny. Who's back there? Siddons? Could it be Paul Siddons? He has the tools and the know-how to expand his office. Could it be?
God damn it, guy. Did you stop suspecting me? I didn't do it.
Oh, hi, Paul. I didn't see you there. I really wasn't accusing you of anything.
Sure, guy, whatever you say. You know, there's a real easy way for us to find out who's responsible.
How?
We'll change the door again. Then we just need to set up a camera, we'll find out who's the scofflaw, and we'll have indisputable proof.
That's an excellent idea. Set it up.
Here we go.
Precisely wrong. A friend of a friend told me that.
You weren't roughly right. You were just wrong.
That's wonderful, Paul. You just hold on to that idea.
I will, because it's right.
Indeed. Indeed.
A dark knight in a communication studies department that knows how to keep its secrets. But on the third floor of Lang Hall, one man is still trying to find the answers to life's persistent questions. Guy Noir, Private Eye.
Do-do-do-do-do-do-do. See, here at Scott's Farmhand Supply, we got a multitude of graduate students to suit your methodological needs.
Like what?
Well, we have qualitative.
I'm here for the ethnographic research.
We got some of that there good quantitative stuff.
I like to count.
We have rhetoric.
What's that?
And creative.
Do what now?
So, Farmer, how are those working out for you?
Well, they're drunk.
Of course.
A lot.
As usual.
And they won't stop talking about heteronormativity.
Do the reading, right?
But they're all right. Thanks, Scott's Farmhand Supply.
That's good to hear. Just remember, if you're familiar with Burke, we'll put you to work. Only at Scott's Farmhand Supply.
Five things said by students waiting for a Phyllis Carlin class. Number one. Did you finish the reading? Number two. I finally figured out how to incorporate Goffman, Bauman, Abrams, Conquer Good, Narrative Analysis, the Folklore Textbook, and my personal research into my project. Everything is there! Number three, I'm performing today and I can't get the projector to work. Number four, I didn't finish the reading. It was 200 pages! Number five, I'm gonna miss this when I graduate.
Many people who couldn't be here tonight send special greetings to Phyllis. Here are just a few. Phyllis, life is unfair. Here I am working harder than a dog, and you, who are much younger than I, are retiring. Regardless, you deserve a happy and relaxed retirement after your 30-plus years of service to UNI. Congratulations. Enjoy yourself. Dean Krugerberg, Charlotte, North Carolina. I'm proud to say that I'm using some of the qualitative skills you taught me. I remember your classes fondly and wish you the best in your retirement. Ryan Crane, Des Moines. Wish I could be there, a true scholar of the Great Plains, a voice in the winds. Gary Balthans, Kinross, Michigan. They say you never know when you will meet the most important people in your life. Who knew when I stalked you at NCA 17 years ago that you would become such a wonderful mentor and friend? You are a true pioneer in our field, and I wish you the best as you set off to explore new worlds yet again. Love, Jane Morgan, Phoenix, Arizona. Dear Phyllis, well, congratulations on taking the great step into Never Never Land. It's a place of surprises and great change, some of which will be under your control. And looking back over my teaching years and the wonderful people I've met, if I were giving out awards today, as I did at the end of each school year, I would give you an award for being the most level-headed and strong-minded student I've ever taught. And all of this packaged in a quiet and delightful demeanor. So with this in mind, I predict that you will continue to make the same wise decisions for your retirement that you have made during your professional career. You can be very proud of your accomplishments. Marv and I wish you and your family continued happiness and count you a good and valuable friend. Marion Kleinem, Carbondale, Illinois. Many folks have been touched by the teaching of Phyllis Carlin, and that may be why she became a teacher in the first place. Back in 1975, when she was at SIU, she and Judy Orton directed a show about the challenges of teaching. Karen Mitchell was in that show, and tonight she will perform a short section from it. Joining her are Darod Taylor and Laura Soul Cryer, former students of Dr. Carlin's, and they will be reading poetry from Farron Clark and Laura Soul Cryer, inspired by their coursework with Phyllis and dedicated to her tonight.
a grocery store or filling teeth or selling insurance. Maybe it's more like farming than anything else.
When as the story sower scattered seeds, I learn the power of stories day by day, but question if my stories were just weeds and wondered, was there something I should say?
Every year there's a new crop. Success means the crop grew and flourished, and failure means it didn't.
Your words were healing to me. When I did not know or I was hurting or I did not want to admit it, hid it from myself and hoped I'd forgive. Outside, put on a strong front, remembering the smile, keep up with your work and run a few miles, and daily dose of this will do the trick.
The growing season is grueling, back-breaking work. Teachers and farmers don't rest